court, so I'm glad I thought about that. So we're talking about the population in this case, and so when we think about population, what we have right now are a bunch of claims on the board, things that we believe the answer might be. And so what we also need, though, is justification. We need a reason why we think that. And when it comes to assessments, I'm going to require that you actually put down your reason why. And I'll show you about the scoring rubric tomorrow. But what I see right now are two major different, or two different schools of thought. Either we think it's the 1,500 students, or it's the 18 to 21-year-old college students. Those are the only two real responses I got. No. And so let's talk about this. So go on.
I don't have my headphones on my phone. I can have one.
No, that's not how it works. Yeah. Thank you, sir. So, what makes a, or what should allow us to make a decision about if it was the 18 to 21 year olds or if it was the 1500? What's, how do we make that decision?
What's the population?
Okay, but how do you know which one it is?
Population is all along. 18 to 21 is just a certain group of.
Okay. There might be some more details to it that we need to consider.
1,500 is just the sample of the population.
That's a claim. Why do you believe that?
Because it's a, it says.
But why do you think that's the sample, not the population? Quite a few of us thought that that was the population. So I need to emphasize this. Get out your textbook. Use your resources during bell ringers. There are two major resources you should use during bell ringers. Anyone know what the first one is?
Our book.
Your notes in your book. That should be a pretty straightforward one. Get those notes out. What's the second resource that you can use during your bell ringer?
The teacher.
Say that louder for everybody than I am. The people in your group. This is a small group activity. Active collaboration is definitely still an expectation for me. Weirdly enough, those are students who are no longer in this class, but thank you. I already checked. Actually, it's not true. Z is one of those, but Z leaves hers in a locker. And number 7 was David Gay, who is no longer in this class. And
nobody even has lockers anymore.
Huh? 6, 11, 17, 22, 25. So whose phone are we missing? The only ones missing are David Gay, number 7, 22, which is Z, she's already talked to me, and 26 is Caitlin Seal. Those are the only phones missing.
Who's Caitlin Seal?
She's no longer in the class. She's in my second block now. Why don't you just complain a little bit more? That's going to help you grow and learn.
I ain't complaining. I
don't know. They had to rearrange their schedule. All right, so look at the notes in your book. Pay attention. Dante, where's your book? M5-78? No, that's not right. That's a, no? Because we're on Module 5, Topic 2, Lesson 1, M5-66. Right, we're on Lesson 1 now. If you're going to make a claim about what a sample is or what a population is, you better have a clear understanding of what a sample is. You better have a clear understanding of what a population is. What does it say is a population? How do we define it?
It represents all possible data.
It represents all possible data. What else did we say about it?
It's the big group we want to know about.
It's the big group we want to know about, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so then what's sample? What makes sample different?
It's a little one.
It's the little one.
It's tiny.
It's tiny.
It's part of the big group.
It's part of the big group. It's part of the population. There's another key detail we're missing. We, in a sample survey, we'll ask them a direct question, but what is the sample? It's the small group. It's the part of the population that we get what from? Data from. So, are we getting data from all 18 to 21 year old college students, or are we getting data from all those 1,500 students?
1,500.
So the data we're getting is from the 1,500. So the 1,500 is the
sample.
The 1,500 students, the 1,500 18 to 21 year olds in college, that's the sample, and we're getting that sample from what bigger group? All 18 to 21 year olds in college. We've got to pay attention to that. There, it's a detail in there. So in there a second. So pay attention. And for the most part, the number, if there's a number, that's going to be a sample because that's the smaller group that we're getting from the bigger group, right? 1,500 students, that may seem like a lot, but at the University of Alabama, there's 40,000 students total. About 25,000 of them are 18 to 21 year old college students. That's just at the University of Alabama. So is 1,500 pretty small?
Yes.
Right? That's the smaller group from the bigger population. The population is all those 18 to 21 year old college students. Make sense?
Where did they get 25 from?
25? I have no idea. Yeah. Characteristic of interest. Nationwide study that asked, or same thing. So what is the characteristic of interest? What key thing should we think about for characteristic of interest?
What do you want to know?
What do you want to know? What did we want to know about for those 18 to 21 year old college students? How many of them took at least one science class? One thing I will point out is, and it's very, very similar, I wouldn't count this against you, it's not actually how many took one science class, it's actually a...
What percent?
Now, it's not the 60%, I'm going to talk about that in a second, but we want to notice it's a percent, because here's the thing, there's a whole lot of 18 to 21-year-old college students, right? So I can't just use how many, because I'm only looking at 1,500 students, but that 1,500, I can figure out what percent of those 1,500 took at least one science class. And then I could try to figure out, so what is the percent of all students who took at least one science class? Okay, so there's that detail there. So it is the percent of college students, or 18 to 21 year old college students, who took at least one science class. I need you to pay attention though. This is something that a lot of students mess up every time. I see people try to use that 60% or something like that. But think about that 60%. Did you know that 60% before you did the study, or is that what you got as a result of the study? That's as a result of the study. That is the statistics. That is the result of the study. That is not the sample. That is not the population. That's not the characteristic of interest. All of those things can be defined before you do the study. So if you say, hey, that's what I got as a result of the study, that's not a sample, that's not a population, that's not a characteristic of interest. Now, the characteristic of interest in general was the percent, but we didn't know the percent before the study started. Okay, so don't use that 60% there. Okay, quick show of thumbs, just do we understand this idea of population, sample, and characteristic of interest better than before we did the bell ringer? So thumb up if we understand a little bit better, thumbs down if we don't at all. Okay. So I do want to point this out, and I need you, across the board, I'm seeing thumbs up at least for understanding it better. You don't have to have mastered it yet, we're going to work on this throughout today, but what I do need you to do is I need you to try the bell ringer, talk about within your small groups, and then we will discuss to help you fully develop your ideas. But you can look at your notes, and that's one of the things that a lot of us are missing is we don't go and look at the notes we took about these things. Mm-hmm. Go and look at your notes. What did we say was the population? Go back to the definition of these terms. You've got to go back to what defines this concept in order to make it work and make it, or to learn from it. All right, we are going to not go over the active collaboration thing as heavily as I did in other classes. I'm still going to touch on it just a hair. But we're mostly going to focus on Module 5, Topic 2, Lesson 1. If you all remember, Friday, we goofed off a little bit too much. We got behind second block. If we are not caught up with second block, then we may end up going into enrichment a little bit. So I need us laser focused so we can catch up to them. One thing I do want to point out on active collaboration, Bryson brought up, he was like, Mr. Kinney, how was this my active collaboration from last week? I missed a one on his score, so like if it would have been like a 16 out of 17, it was a 6 out of 17. That's not what his score was, because I don't want to tell other people, but check your scores, make sure they make sense, and ask questions. I'll be more than happy to talk about it, because yeah, I just missed a one, and that makes a huge difference on the active collaboration grade. So if you see that, be aware. Don't forget, active collaboration, this is not just a grade. The big thing I want you to recognize is that this is supposed to be me telling you what I'm expecting out of you. If you are actively collaborating, which means in the whole class discussion, you can share thoughts, ask questions, or take notes, and in small group discussion, you're talking through these ideas and trying to make sense out of these problems. If you're actively collaborating, what are you also going to do? You're going to talk, but in order to do, yes, you're going to do that, but like, if you're actively collaborating, if you're talking, you're going to what? What is the priority of this class?
Learn.
Say it louder.
Learn.
You're going to learn.
Learn.
I'm telling you the things to be successful in the learning process. And again, that does not necessarily mean that you're going to make A's or B's, but that does mean that you're going to learn. And if you learn, you're going to be okay with me. But you still may have to put in some time and effort outside of class. You may have to watch the videos that I record each day to help do homework assignments or study. You might have to come into tutoring when you're still struggling, ask questions during enrichment. But if you are doing these things, you're going to learn. And if you're at threes and below, are you going to learn as much as someone who's earning fours and above?
I would take it.
So I haven't sent out, I meant to do it this weekend, and I realized this morning I didn't. I'm going to share with you a Google sheet. So I've already started entering the scores onto a Google sheet, which I'll share with you and your parent. I'll share it with just you for now. And once I send out my next newsletter, I'll share it with your parents as well so they understand what the scores are. But that way you can see what you're earning each day, right? But the big thing again is actively collaborate. Get involved in the learning process. The person who talks the most learns the most. Talk during your small group discussion and check in with each other's understanding. Go back to your notes and use those to help you grow and learn. During whole class discussion, take notes and share your ideas and ask questions. You do those things, you're going to grow and learn. All right, so objectives, we want to identify population, samples, and characteristics of interest. We already did that some. We also need to continue differentiating surveys, observational studies, and experiments. So this is the beginning of the lesson, right? This is one of the major lessons that will be on the understanding check on Thursday. Yes, we will have our first assessment on Thursday. You need to know and be able to apply all of these key terms. This is on page 65. All right, page 66, the getting started, is where we really looked at population sample and characteristic of interest. The thing I want to focus on really quickly is this sample survey. What makes something a sample survey? Asking direct questions of your samples, right? If you ask someone a question, you're doing a sample survey. If you're doing a questionnaire, you're doing a sample survey. And that's one type of study. But then we also looked here at we talked about random samples, bias samples. Let me come back to that in a second. Here at on activity 1.2, did we talk about observational studies a little bit? This is page 70. Did we start this part? That's where we got to?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So observational studies, notice we're not going to directly ask questions. We are literally going to what?
Look at
data. Right? Data are gathered by a characteristic of a population by simply observing or describing events or just looking at data that was given. So I do want to talk about this quickly and then we'll probably go to lunch. One thing on activity 1.1 I do want to point out is this. We want our sample to be as close to the what as possible? Population.
Oh, population.
Right? Remember over here when we collected data with Hide by Juice World, when you got to choose your five words, in general, were our five chosen words close to that population value, the parameter? No. For the most part, didn't you choose bigger words than what the actual population looked like? Yes?
Yeah.
When we randomly did it, notice, does every sample hit right on the parameter value, that line there?
Mm-hmm. No.
I mean, I got points over here, but notice how the parameter is in the center of our data sets, right? That's what we mean when we say representative. It means that our sample is right around that parameter. So if it is a random sample, our sample will be representative of the population. And if it is not representative, we call it biased.
Biased.
And biased does not mean that the sample always, that it, biased does not mean that the samples never get the population. Biased means that the majority of our samples will miss. We will consistently, time and again, miss the population values.
Whoa, not that far.
Not quite. Questions about, hey, questions about representative versus biased. Get it there.
No.
And so what type of sampling do we have to have in order to get a representative sample?
Random.
It has to be random. There's other ways to unfortunately increase bias, but you are guaranteed to get a biased sample if you do not do random sampling. All right, head to lunch. When you come back, we will pick up with activity 1.2.